It's always good to be in the house of the Lord with y'all. Y'all doing good? I tell you, when I was a kid, I grew up in a private school, and every year, even when I was in kindergarten, I can remember some of the things we did around February time, and that was, when I can remember being in the early years, we had pictures of Abraham Lincoln and George Washington, and I can remember even coloring them in. I can remember as time would go forth, we would have to learn some speeches, we'd have to learn, write reports on their lives, and so I was thinking about this week some of the things that I learned about Abraham Lincoln and George Washington, and I thought it would be apropos to talk a little bit today about freedom. We have so many freedoms in our society, and a lot of times, how many of you know we can take our freedoms for granted? The fact that you and I can meet here today in Jesus' name, that we can have the freedom of worship. A lot of countries are persecuted for their faith. And so there was a speech, it was a passionate proclamation of our freedom, which we find in the Gettysburg Address. Here we see that Abraham Lincoln was addressing the crowd. He was not the main speaker that day, but it became a very famous speech. And I want to say it to you, and most of you probably will recognize the first five words of this, and probably none of the rest of it. But the speech goes like this, 87 years ago. How many of you have heard that before? Okay. Now you guys will be lost. Here we go. He says this, 87 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived or so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate that portion of that field as a final resting place for those who have given their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggle here have consecrated it. Far above our poor power to add or to detract, the world will little note nor no longer remember that we stay here, but we cannot forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they have fought here, have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task that remains before us, that from this honored day, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave their last full measure of devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, for the people, should not perish from earth. Isn't that a great speech? He's talking about the freedoms, the foundations that we have under God, a nation under God. It is amazing that even in our nation, we are seeing some of our liberties and some of our even religious freedoms being taken away. It seems to happen so ever so slowly. I heard recently that a federal cemetery cannot use God's name at funeral services. Can you imagine? At a federal cemetery. There was a case here recently in the city council of Eugene, Oregon, that wanted to take God out of the Pledge of Allegiance. I was asked to pray at the County Board of Supervisors down in Southern California, and I was there, and there was a bunch of people, and I was in chambers, and I was going out, and all of them were walking in, and probably about 15 minutes before I was going to walk out and do a prayer, the guy who was in charge says, now, when you pray, make sure that you don't pray in Jesus' name. I'm going, said, I'm a Christian minister. If he didn't want me to pray in Jesus' name, why didn't you invite me? And so when I prayed, I forgot what he said, and I prayed in Jesus' name anyway. But... we have detracted ourselves from the true meaning of freedom. We think that freedom means that we can do whatever we want to do. That is why millions of babies are being killed today, and we call it free choice. That's why we have magazines, internet, movie theaters filled with pornography, and we call it free speech. That is why we can have satanic worship and all kinds of cult worship, and we call it freedom of religion. I believe that we can't forget what our forefathers have done. I believe in our generation, we don't know what it means to fight for freedoms. And I want to talk to you today about a greater freedom. Just like in our nation, we can take for granted the freedoms we have. And a lot of times, even in a spiritual sense, we can take the freedoms we have for granted, can't we? Look at the very first verse on your outline this morning. It's found in John chapter 8, verses 31 through 32, and then we're going to look at verse 36. And it says this. So Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed him, if you continue in my, say it with me, word, then you are truly disciples of mine. And you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. It is the freedom that we have in Christ. Real freedom does not come from being an American. Real freedom does not mean being a Republican or a Democrat or a conservative or a liberal. Based upon the scripture that we just read, real freedom comes from being tied to the Word of God. Staying connected with the pure Word of God daily is true freedom. And I think we have to look at the big picture and lean closer to God. We cannot be enslaved, I think, by those things around us, but we need to stay in the freedom and in the truth of God's Word. In fact, if you have a pen and you're taking notes, I underline the part where it says, if you continue in my Word, then you are truly my disciples. And then you will know the truth, and it is that truth that sets you free. It's not a philosophical type of truth. It is a truth that leads to salvation. And some of the things that we take for granted is there are things that can enslave us that can be ever so subtle and ever so small. Because a lot of times when we think of being enslaved, we think of addictions, right? There's some really bad addictions that seem to get a hold of people's lives, and it is hard for them to get out of those addictions, and they can spend their whole lives wrestling. The Bible says this in Psalm 91, that He, meaning God, will deliver you from the snares of the fowler. Because the enemy of our soul wants to enslave people, because no one feels victorious in their salvation. No one feels spiritually victorious when they're enslaved in some sort of sin. Right? And so what happens is the enemy, he puts those traps to try to enslave you, that you will be into the bondage of sin and you won't be free. And that's where we need to grab a hold of the truth of God's Word to be free. But sometimes they're not those things like addictions. They can be very subtle things that can grab a hold of our minds. And I want to talk about, briefly, about forgotten freedoms. The first one, if you write this down, is the freedom from worry. The freedom from worry. Now, that doesn't seem like kind of a big deal, but I did a lot of counseling about this last couple of weeks, so that's why I'm talking about it, because a lot of times the enemy can get a hold of our mind, and we worry, and we worry, and we worry. In the Greek and Hebrew translation, worry means an undivided mind. When you worry, you have a preoccupation with the things that causes your mind to get stressed and anxiety, and you're like the ocean being tossed from to and fro. Some people get sick with worry. I believe we live in a society with worry. And what happens is, the very root of worry is our lack of trust in God, that God has our best interest at heart. Worrying is not trusting God for the big picture. Worrying is not holding on to the truth of God's word that says, well, all things work together for good to those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. And the enemy will come along and he'll try to rip that right away from you. You heard me talk about, I was at the hospital last week of a my hearing thing? Time to wake up. Anyway. Somebody set that alarm, so you know, after 15 minutes of the sermon, I'm going to set that alarm so I can wake up. But anyway. I told you a story about a gentleman I went to go see in his late 40s, and they found cancer involved in his pancreas and his liver. And he's there trying to not worry, but hold on to faith. And he's saying how that means this was planning things in his mind, like, where is your God now? And so what I did, I was there just giving him the truth of God's word. Because it's in those times when we need something to hold on to, and it is those things of truth. When people call me, basically they're not calling for my wisdom, really. They're calling for the presence of God, so to speak, right? And so it is God's presence in that situation where our strength comes. It is the freedom that we can trust upon the things of God and not be enslaved to the whisperings of things that are false and lies, because the Bible says the enemy is the father of lies. And he wants us to hold on to those things, to not have hope, to not walk in faith, to not walk into the freedom of God's word. All those things work together for good. We are short-sighted a lot of times. Now look at the scripture found in 2 Corinthians 3:17. This is a song that we sang this morning that says this: "For the Lord is the Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is," say it with me,
"freedom."
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So again, when people call me to go visit them in the hospital, when people go, they want the presence of the Lord. Where the presence of the Lord is, there's a sense of freedom where people feel free up. I've even seen people who, I was in a room when they breathed their very last breath, and they went ready to go, and they were there in all peace and all hope and all comfort and a sense of looking forward. And I've had several people say, "Pastor, I'm ready to go," with an excitement. And that's the presence of the Lord. There is a freedom from the fear of death. There's a freedom from the fear of worry. Those freedoms that we take for granted that we get to experience all the time. It is a freedom that the Lord gives us. Psalm 86:11 says this. Psalm 86:11. He says, "Teach me your way, Lord, that I may rely on your faithfulness. Give me an undivided heart that I might fear your name." Isn't that a great verse? Listen. Teach me. Lord, teach me your way that I may rely on your faithfulness. When we get in a situation, we need to know God's way, because there's a lot of times we're not faithful. A lot of times people in our lives aren't faithful. But let me say this, God is always faithful.
Amen.
So, God, let me know your word. God, teach me your word in my heart that I might rely. You know what, there's not a whole lot of things we can rely on. Come on. Anybody rely on the stock market? How about the real estate market? How about the politicians? Yeah. Pretty shaky, huh? That's why, teach me, God. Teach me that I can rely on your faithfulness. God is faithful. God, please give me an undivided heart that I may fear the presence, that I can reverence, that I'll be knowing that a holy, awesome God is there to help me. That if God is for me, who could be against me? Oh, God, teach me to rely on your faithfulness. Forgotten freedoms. freedom from worry. I can trust God in all things. See, the enemy tries to whisper, don't trust God. Don't do this. He's going to steal all your joy. He'll steal all your fun. People think that freedom is doing anything you want. You know what? If you could do anything you want, you ain't free. You'll probably be in bondage real quick. Left to ourselves. That's what God teaches me. Because the Bible says there's a way that seems right in man's eyes, but if we keep going in that direction, it leads to what? Destruction. That's why we need God to teach us His ways. Number two, forgot freedom. Freedom from guilt. Freedom from guilt. Guilt, by definition, means that we don't feel that we're good enough. Again, the enemy tries to whisper in our ear when we're nothing. The redeeming value, how God looks upon you and see how valuable you are, is represented by the cross that we have here today. He found value in each one of us that He was willing to die upon the cross. 1 John 1:9. You got to love that verse. It says this: if we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from unrighteousness. Don't you love that? Don't we take for granted the freedom that we have in Christ? Don't we take for granted? The Bible says that if we didn't have the cross and the forgiveness thereof, we couldn't bear underneath the weight of it. But we have the forgiveness. Someone gave this to me when I did a sermon a few Easters ago. If you're under 30, you probably don't know what this is. How many know what this is? How many of you have never seen this before? Because you've been playing video games all your life. Okay. I tell you, we were poor, so this was our version of video games. I can remember playing this in the back seat of a car, and the first service related to this because we were so poor. We had to see how old some of you are, but we had that spool of thread where you put a rubber band through it, a match stick, and a soap, and you would make a tractor. Maybe you. You were poor too. Very good. We were so poor. We had these toys where you wind up like this. But anyway, an etch-a-sketch. I can remember making things and going through and you make a mistake. And you know what's great about this? You turn upside down and you shake it and you get a brand new start. Because you know we can all mess up, we can all screw up. We can give into the lies of Satan and we believe he's the father of lies. And sometimes we buy into that. Doesn't that make you mad? But thank the Lord that we have freedom in Christ, that we can come and say, oh God, forgive me of my sins. And you know what? Folks, it's not just lip service, it's something called repentance. That means we don't continue sinning, that God's grace be abound. We don't continue this way, but we repent and we turn in a different direction and we go towards Christ. It is freedom from guilt. Romans 8:1-2 says this: therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. See, in other words, we're not condemned. Do you know there's a lot of people who won't come to church today because they feel condemned? But the Bible says in Christ there's no condemnation because all the condemnation Jesus was, listen, condemned for us. That's why we have freedom from condemnation, because He was condemned on our behalf. Because the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. And He took that death for us. In fact, measured up to the law in the Bible, measured up to the law in the Bible, you know what happens? We all fail. That's why the Bible says the law was given to teach us something. You know what it teaches us? We can't follow it. So on Judgment Day, we'll be measured. People will be measured to the perfection of the law. And Jesus came, listen, he says, to fulfill all the law and the prophets and to fulfill all the word of God in his life, and then he died for us. He fulfilled it all. So what happens is, measured to the law, we fail, but Jesus steps in because he fulfilled the perfection of the law because he is perfect. And then the last one is freedom from the consequences of sin. Freedom from the consequences of sin. The consequences of sin is what? Death. That's why we don't continue into sin. Look what it says in Galatians 5:1-13. He says this: it was for freedom that Christ set us free. Therefore, keep standing firm and do not be subject again to the yoke of what? Slavery. For you were called to freedom, brethren. Only do not turn your freedom into an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. I can remember one time in an interview, they were interviewing Jerry Falwell, who was president of Liberty University. And the newscaster was trying to trap him, and he was saying, he goes, how can you call your school Liberty University? And the newscaster actually had the rules and the regulations of the university. He says, how can you call it Liberty University where you can't do this? You can't drink, you can't date, you can't do this? And Jerry Falwell says, well, we have freedom from all those sexual diseases. Well, we have freedom from alcoholism because of this. So there is freedom. God sets those things that we don't get entangled. Just like we saw Israel in bondage in Egypt. The enemy of our soul wants to put us in bondage. The enemy of our soul does not want us to be free. You know that? And he will set up those little traps I talk about often. Any of you ever seen a bear trap? How about a rat trap? Come on. Those pesky little rats. See, every trap, I don't care if you're catching mice or you're catching elephants, every trap is based upon the same formula. You know what it is? One word. Deception. The enemy wants to deceive us that we're getting something, just like Adam and Eve. If you eat of this fruit, you will be just like God. It was a deception. Every trap, our mouth thinks he's getting a piece of cheese. Right? And so those things can snare us, entrap us. And the enemy is very subtle. He will use very small little things, little areas of compromise that adds up to huge things. Right? How many of you know if you have a small leak in a big ship, it's eventually going to go down? Right? I hear there's cheap cruises in Italy, but anyways. Have to throw that in there. There's a lot of illustrations, and one that I particularly like is that story, how pumpkins don't hurt ducks. If Indians were going to eat ducks, and they were going to catch them with a bow and arrow, the Indians would go hungry. Because ducks are very hard to catch with a bow and arrow. So what the Indians would do in this particular village is, they had ducks in the river, and they would take a pumpkin, and they would let the pumpkin float down the river, and the ducks would see the pumpkin. You know what they'd do? Fly away. They would come back, the Indian, because they had a lot of time, they didn't work 9 to 5, they got another pumpkin, they let it go down the river, and the ducks would fly away, but eventually they would come back. And they would do this, the ducks would fly away, and they would come back sooner, and then they would keep doing it until the ducks would kind of flutter, and then they would stay there, and then they would get a pumpkin and let it go down the river until the ducks said this: pumpkins don't hurt ducks. So when the Indians got them convinced that pumpkins don't hurt ducks, the Indians would carve out a big pumpkin, put it on their head, and they would float down the Hamptons, and they would see the feet of the ducks, and they would grab it. And they would have ducks. All because pumpkins don't hurt ducks. You know what? I have people, even this week, say, I don't know how I got into it, Pastor. And I thought pumpkins don't hurt ducks. So you know what? I just took one drink. Nothing happened. Man, I just tried this drug just one time, and it was okay. And I tried it again. I had somebody who said, you know, I just looked on the internet for pornography just one time, and then I kept looking, and I kept going, and he said it affected my life, and it affected my family, and it affected my job, and it affected everything. A lot of times we'll say that pumpkins don't hurt ducks. Come on. Know that the enemy of your soul wants to enslave you, but there is truth in God's word. It is his truth that sets us free. That's why we need to be in God's word all the time, that we can recognize what hurts us. Because the Lord wants us free. The enemy comes to rob, steal, and to destroy you. But Jesus came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Look at this last verse here today. It's in the Message Bible, so it's really kind of plain English. And I love the way it says it here in Romans 6, 20 and 23. He says, as long as you did what you felt like doing, ignoring God, you didn't have to bother with right thinking or right living or right anything for that matter. But do you call that a free life? What did you get out of it? Nothing you're proud of now. Where did it get you? A dead end. But now that you've found, you don't have to listen to sin tell you what to do, and have discovered the delight of listening to God telling you, what a surprise! A whole, healed, put-together life right now, with more and more life on the way. Work hard for sin your whole life, and your pension is death. But God's gift is real life. Eternal life delivered by Jesus, our Master. If we're not a master to, if the Lord is not our master, there will things that will master us and ruin our life. The enemy wants to rob, steal, and kill from you. Jesus wants you to be free. And whom the Son sets free is free indeed. If we are in the truth of God's word, we will not fall for the lies of the enemy, who is the father of lies, who wants to bring out the worst in your life. That's why we need to submit to the Master Jesus, who wants to bring out the very best in your life, that you will live a life of freedom, a great life before the Lord. And it is all about the cross. Again, so often we can take the freedoms of our nation for granted. And how often can you and I, without thinking about it, take for granted the freedoms that we have in Jesus Christ? Amen? The point is today, if you get nothing else, I want you to get this. And you can underline it's found in the very first verse. If you continue in my word. Would you underline that? Continue in my word. Because then we are his disciples, and then he says, then you will know the truth. So I want to encourage you today to know the truth of God's word on a daily basis. You will not take for granted all that Christ has done for you. You are so valuable, he died for you. Don't take your freedoms for granted. Amen? Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for your word today that speaks to our very hearts. Lord, I thank you for those who have gone before us. Lord, that we have the freedoms in our nation. Lord, I thank you for the spiritual freedoms we have in our nation today. Lord, I pray that those would be preserved. But Lord, in a greater way, I thank you for your freedoms, and may they be preserved in our hearts. That we won't take for granted the cross, the pain, the scourging, the death. Lord, that you stepped in for us. Oh God, we thank you. Oh God, thank you. Lord, may we never take for granted the freedoms that we have in you. Lord, I pray that you will cause us to be wise in the ways of the enemy. Lord, that we would not be ensnared, enslaved by the world and the enemy who wants to enslave us, who wants to bring out the worst in us. But Lord, may we be reminded of your word that sets us free. Lord, cause us not to be lazy, but Lord, cause us to be diligent in seeking out your truth. Not that philosophical truth, but Lord, the truth that leads to salvation. The truth that leads us to freedom. Lord, you say you are the truth. And so, Lord, we receive you today. Lord, touch us. Lord, thank you. Thank you, thank you for the spiritual freedoms that we have in you. We celebrate that. We're careful to be grateful to thank you. Oh God, we thank you. Lord, we receive you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said,
amen.
How many of you are glad you're free today?
Amen.
Would you stand and let's sing this song. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom.
Prayer, we finish this chorus right here. If you feel you need a little more prayer, our prayer partner is going to be right up here. And you're welcome to come up. We're going to have a few minutes here to reach this room.